Last week, we looked at what it means to be a godly wife. The chief characteristic of a godly wife is the spirit of submission. She's respectful towards her husband. And I pray that as wives, you would take this word of God and say, "Dear God, help me be that wife you want me to be." But I also hope that the husbands did not take the sermon last week and abuse it towards your wife. Meaning, you hold it up and you criticize her and you demand of her. I don't think that's the spirit we need to approach the subject last week, because I'm sure this is not the spirit you want your wife to come in to this morning as well. Because this morning we are looking at the loving husband. And the one thing the husband doesn't want is for the wife to take notes today and go home and say, "See, see, see, see." You see, that is not the spirit by which we need to hear the word of God. For the husband, I say to you, hear this message and pray to God that He will change your life and make you the husband He wants you to be. But as a wife, you come, you hear this message, not so much you find ammunition to criticize your husband, but that you find points and spheres and arenas to pray for your husband. So I hope last week, husbands, don't abuse your wives. Pray for your wives. This week, wives, hear the word of God and pray also for your husbands. But this is a message today focusing on being a loving husband. Now, I think preaching to the husband is harder than preaching to the wives. Why? Number one, I think the standard that we are called to as husbands is higher than that of the wives, simply because we are called to be leaders in the family. But number two, why I think this is so difficult for husbands is that husbands are generally very blur. Believe it or not, men are very poor in marriage. We are very blur with regards to how a marriage should work. I saw this video clip. I'm going to share this with you. It's by Gary Smalley. He's a marriage expert, a counselor. He's a Christian teacher. Now, this video is done in humor. So it is to show what you are not supposed to be, all right? So listen to this with a pinch of salt and convince yourself, husbands, we are really bad in marriage.
Hi, I'm Dr. Gary Smalley, and I've been helping marriages for years improve. And I've got a couple of friends who have some very unique insights into marriage, and I want you to meet them.
Hey, thank you, Gary. My name is Johnny.
And I'm Chachi.
And you know, marriages is something that I think we're all excited about and something that we think we can bring a lot of wisdom to. Isn't that right, Dr. Dobson?
Smalley?
That's sorry. Our faux pas. Yes, we've got some killer marriage tips that we think are really going to knock your socks off. Yeah. So let's do some dancing, get this party started, and help marriages out all over the country. Let's do it.
Let's go ahead and just roll with the tips. No dancing. When you get the chance, finish your wife's sentences.
For her.
Yeah. It's important that she knows that you know where she's going with a particular thought or sentence.
Yeah, this says, "I know you, I love you, and you're predictable, but in a good way."
When on vacation, have fun, but make sure your wife knows exactly how much this thing is costing. Now remember, allowing her to feel guilt can actually be a good thing.
Right you are, because guilt is actually an acronym for good financial stewardship.
No, that's...
Yeah, it is.
It does not make sense. When you're in an argument, it's key to use the time that your spouse is talking to come up with what you want to say next. So it goes like this. You speak, and then while she's speaking, you think, and then you speak again.
And that's how the killer comebacks happen.
Surprise your wife with a weekend trip for you and your buddies. Husbands, doing this will help her see that you're taking care of your needs.
And taking care of your needs will give you the ability to take care of her needs. You know, putting your kids in timeout works for most parents. But putting your spouse in timeout can also be really effective. Putting your spouse in the timeout chair will hopefully help her see things from a different perspective, preferably yours.
And if you get any pushback, I'd let her know that you're having a hard time telling her apart from the children.
That's classic. I like that.
Whenever your wife tells you about something she wants to buy, respond with the sound effect of a cash register. Here's a little role play for you. Hey, honey, I'm going to go buy some skinny jeans.
Cha-ching.
Hey, honey, I'm going to go get some bread now.
Cha-ching.
You know, guys, those are kind of horrible tips.
Okay.
I guess she didn't like them that much.
I mean, when you think about it, those were killer tips, and I think they'd, like, kill most marriages.
Well, I guess we're at an impasse then.
Yeah. Awkward.
So today we're going to look at the loving husband. So important. Six tips you will forget. Six terrible, horrible tips you will forget. But I hope today you remember this, all right? Husbands are to be loving husbands. You see, the Bible is very clear. It doesn't call you to be a rich husband, a handsome husband, a smart husband. It calls you to be a loving husband. In Ephesians chapter 5, the verses go, "Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. In the same way, husbands should love their wives," verse 28. And then in verse 33, it's the same thing. "However, let each one of you love his wife as himself." So it's very clear that the demand of Scripture is that we will be loving husbands. And that is the chief characteristic we must have in leading our homes. Before the first service this morning, someone came up to me and said, a husband, of course, he came up to me, shook my hand and said, "Pastor, 手下留情, means have mercy upon us. Well, let me say this. As I share on the loving husband, the first person who needs this message is myself. Above anything else, as I go through the word and as I preach with you, I feel like a hypocrite. But here we are going to look at least what Scripture has to say about being a loving husband. Now, it's easy to say we've got to love, but what does it really look like if we are a loving husband? So let's break it down into five very simple aspects of true love. A loving husband will have true love, and true love looks like this, all right? First of all, let's define love. What is love? Love is not about feelings. Love is not about myself. I believe one of the best definitions I can think of for love is that it is an unconditional giving of yourself for the good of another. So a good husband is someone who understands this and lives this out. He understands that I am to unconditionally give myself for the good of my wife. Notice it has nothing to do with I love her because I enjoy being with her. It has nothing to do with I love her because she's my best friend. I love her because I feel most satisfied and fulfilled with her. It has nothing to do with you. It's nothing to do with feelings. Love is an action. Love is the unconditional giving of yourself for the good of another. So today, looking at the loving husband with that basic definition, let's break it down into five simple parts, five different perspectives of true love. Number one, I believe true love is sensitive. In other words, it is aware, it is alert, it is attentive. Notice Peter saying to us in 1 Peter chapter 3, "Likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel." The Bible doesn't allow for a man to abuse his authority and bully his wife. No, the Bible tells us you've got to understand your wife so that you may honor her. The King James says, "Live with your wives according to knowledge." So it begins right here. If you want to be a loving husband, you've got to be someone who understands your wife, or at least working always towards understanding your wife. Do you understand your wife? How many of you say, "I understand"? How many of you dare to say you understand your wife? Can I see by a show of hands? Okay, after I use the word dare, nobody dares. But I find this very true. In the Chinese, we say, 女人心海底针. Wow, very good, your Chinese. What does it mean? It means the woman's heart is like a needle at the bottom of the ocean. Can you search for it? Very hard, isn't it? And so the Chinese say 女人心海底针, it's very hard to really grasp and understand what the woman has to think. And similarly, in the Western world, we have this statement, men are from Mars and women are from Venus. And so it's a very different world we come from. The husband, you may think you really understand your wife, but the reality is oftentimes we don't. It's very hard. Story is told of a couple. The wife is turning 40, and so the husband wanted to grant her a very, very pleasant birthday memory. And so he asked her, "Dear, what would you like for birthday celebration? What would you really, really want?" The wife thought for a moment and says, "Dear, I really want to be 10 again." And so he wanted to make a very, very memorable surprise or birthday celebration. And so he went ahead to book a McDonald's restaurant, booked the whole place, and then decorated it with all the fun, kiddie stuff, got happy meals for all the guests. So he had a great time. After that, he brought her to the amusement park, took all the kinds of rides, kiddie rides, exciting rides, and they had such a wonderful time enjoying just being 10 again. Now, after going through all the rides, it was late at night. She went home. She collapsed on the bed because she was so tired. And her husband came to her and says, "Dear, did you enjoy the birthday party I planned for you and all the day's events?" The wife says, "Well, I really appreciate it, but I'm really, really tired. But did you like it?" Says, "Not really." "But why? I thought you wanted to be 10 again." And she opened her eyes so big and looked at him with such a look of incredulity that she said, "Dear, I meant size 10, not age 10. It's very hard to understand our wives. But the Bible says you've got to live with your wives in an understanding way. You've got to dwell with her according to knowledge. By the way, men and women have very different needs. Just to help you along, if men you don't already know, do you know what are the top 5 needs of a man in marriage? I asked the first service, nobody knew. Men, what are your top 5 needs in marriage? Sorry? Appreciation, okay, good. Sorry? Respect, that's what was preached last week, good. Okay, women, what do you need in marriage? Love, okay, good. What else? Huh? Let me break it down for you, all right? According to Chuck Swindoll, he's a well-known Bible teacher, in his book, Great Awakening, he gives you 5 needs of the wives and then 5 needs of the husband, or reverse it. Let me show you first the 5 needs of the husband. Number 1, sexual fulfillment. Number 2, recreational companionship. Number 3, an attractive spouse. Number 4, domestic support. Number 5, admiration and respect. These are the needs of the men. What about the needs of the wife? Would it be the same? Do you expect it to be the same? Now, all of you men are looking at this, yeah, it should be the same. Should be the same. You wish. The whole difficulty in marriage is that men are from Mars and women are from Venus. So we often misread and misrepresent each other. So let's look at the needs of the wife. It's very different. The needs of the wife, number 1, right on top of the list, affection. Number 2, conversation. Number 3, honesty and openness. Number 4, financial support. Number 5, family commitment. This is, of course, according to surveys of the ladies and the men that were in the States. But these are the different needs. And if, as a man, you think that loving your wife means bringing food, bringing money back home, you ain't going to meet the needs of your wife. Because so often, we men in Singapore, we think that all it takes in marriage is for me to work hard, bring in the money, and that's all my wife wants from me. After all, that's all I want for myself. No. If you just bring in the money, if you just earn the keeps, you have not begun to meet the needs of your wife. So you've got to understand them. You can bring in a car, a house, but at the end of the day, she will tell you, "But this is not what I want. I'm not met in my needs. I'm not fulfilled in my life. Because she needs more than those things you thought were sufficient for her. Now, is it easy to understand your wife? Not really. That's why you've got to work at it. You've got to study. You've got to listen to your wife. You've got to find out from her what she really wants. And would you do that? You should do that because true love is sensitive. It's aware. It's attentive. By the way, that's the same way Jesus loved us. Think about it. Jesus did not only die for us, He came in our flesh. He came in human flesh so that He may understand us. The Bible tells us He was tempted in all points like as we are. Why? So that He may fully understand us. So that He may be our compassionate and merciful high priest. He was touched in every point like as we are. You see, He came to understand fully who we are. Husband who loves his wife does the same thing. He seeks to understand her. So, if you want to love your wife, it begins right here. Would you work at understanding her and not just providing for her? It begins right here. True love is sensitive. Number two, true love obviously is sacrificial. Not only must you know what she wants and what she needs, you must be willing to sacrifice to give to her. Love, in its essence, is sacrifice. Love, in its essence, is about giving. And true love is about giving. It's giving without expecting something in return. By the way, that's what giving is. You give not because you give to your wife not because you want something from her, but you give to your wife because you love her. You're willing to sacrifice, not asking anything in return. And by the way, giving, I say, is not just in the big things. You know, when we talk about sacrifice, we always think about, you know, about this man who is willing to jump into the river to save her wife. And we think it's that once-in-a-lifetime drama, mama stuff. But no, I think sacrifice is best seen in a day-to-day life. You see, true love is sacrificial. I'm willing to die for my wife. Let me ask you, are you willing to die for your wife every day? Say, how? In doing the little things of life. There's this lady, this wife who said to the husband, "Dear, I know you're willing to die for me. You have said it many times. But whilst you are waiting to die, can you at least get up and help me sweep the floor?" Dying for your wife is about the little things of life. And I think it's very real, especially when you're working outside in your career, in your office, after a hard day's work. You know, the natural man says, after a hard day's work, what do I want when I go home? I want to be pampered like a king. It's my territory. It's my lair. It's my den. This is my world. And so when I go home, I expect my wife and so on to take care of me. But you do know what is dying to self? Dying to self means even after a terrible day at work, you go home, not expecting to be served by your wife, but you go home dying for your wife, sacrificing for her. You're tired, she's tired, but you say, "Dear, you go and take a rest. I'll do this. I'll take care of this." And when you do that, you're dying to yourself a little every time. But that's what real love is. It's in the small things. It's not in the big things. Yes, it will come, but begin with the small things. Wives, won't you be happy if your husband were to just die for you every day in those ways? Washing the dishes, sweeping the floor, taking care of the kids so that you can have some time on your own. Wouldn't it be great if he's willing to just be not so stingy and bring you out for a nice dinner once in a while? By the way, it takes dying for the husband to do that. But that's all part of sacrifice, dying for your spouse. Let me show you another video. This video is about how men are generally romantically challenged. We are not very good in love and romance. But a real hero, a real man of faith, a real man who walks with Jesus is someone who sacrifices for his wife and for his kids. So this is again a humorous video. Hope you enjoy it, and may this register also in your mind.
I am a man romantically challenged. Although I don't like to talk or share my feelings, I am here tonight to do both because I love my wife.
Hey guys, I'm Jerry, and I was romantically challenged. Remember when we talked about how we're supposed to love our wives like Christ loves the church? Well, gentlemen, mission accomplished. Okay? This weekend, I saw some extra charges on Cindy's bank card. So, yeah. But I instead of yelling and screaming like I normally would, I acted in a more Christ-like manner.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I simply turned over her nightstand and her scrapbooking table and said, "Get out of here, money changer." I was like, "Get out of here."
I don't think that's what the Ephesians 5 passage means.
Okay. I'm sorry, Bill Gates. Who are you?
No, I think when it says that we should love our wives like Christ loved the church, that means that we're supposed to serve and sacrifice.
Hey, I was cleansing the temple. I was cleansing the temple.
Okay, different perspective, not necessarily right, just different.
All right, I think the question is, how many of you have ever done anything for your wife without desiring anything in return?
Are you even married?
Jesus wasn't married. Now look, the point I'm trying to... No, I'm not, and that stings a little bit. I have read parts of a lot of relationship books, and if anyone thinks they can lead this group better than I can, put your hand down, Jerry. I am sharing my feelings, and that's what you need to do with your wives. Practice makes perfect. Who wants to go next?
I guess I could give it a shot. Hi, guys. My name is Sheldon, and I am romantically challenged.
Hi, Sheldon.
I thought I'd just share a few things from the program that I've learned so far. First, if your wife says she doesn't know where she wants to go eat, well, that's pretty much code for Italian and expensive Italian. And secondly, if you're getting her an anniversary gift, the Snuggies, not really a very good idea, even if it's the leopard print. Learn that one the hard way. And then third, the simple act of doing dishes is a big, big win. I mean, a big one. So do all the dishes you can. Thanks.
I have no idea what you said, but that was good. Bathroom break isn't yet.
Sorry, I gotta go. Sorry, guys.
Oh, Mr. Big Guy doesn't want to share, does he?
Not tonight.
Probably doesn't care about his wife.
Okay, I'll share. Okay. This is a picture of my wife and kids. I've been married for 20 years. We married young, and I don't regret it. Have we had our share of storms? Sure. Do we have some amazing memories? Too many to mention. Do I try to fix things? I do. But it's just because after 20 years of marriage, I still want to ride in and be my wife's knight in shining armor. I remember when we got engaged, her father looked at me and he said, "Just love her the way Christ loved the church." I smiled and said I would, having no idea what that meant. And I still don't know if I understand it. But you know what I want? I want to be a man who wakes up every morning and asks the question, "How can I bless my wife?" And God, men, isn't that what you want? I mean, isn't your wife worth it?
Hey, wait. Oh, Captain, my Captain?
Sit down, Jerry.
Oh, Captain, my Captain.
Okay, enough. Sit down. What is going on? Sit down. Please, sit down. I need a wife.
Well, that's a real man, isn't it? A real man who follows Jesus is someone who doesn't use his wife but gives himself for his wife. That's what Jesus did. And I say to you, it's not easy. It's never easy to sacrifice. It's never easy to live for others because We are so sinful in our thinking. We are so self-centered in the way we operate. But look to Jesus. Be broken before Jesus. If you're here to lord over your wife, if you're here to use your authority to clobber her head, that's not real manhood. A real man is someone who serves and sacrifices and gives himself for her. True leadership is not lording over people. True leadership is loving people. Jesus did it. And may our husbands love our wives the way Jesus loved his church, by giving himself. So true love is sacrificial. But thirdly, can I move on? Because time is short. Besides the fact that true love is sensitive, you've got to know how to love them and you've got to be willing to love them, can I add that emotional touch to love? And that is, true love is also sweet. See, this is what the Bible says in Ephesians 5. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and, look at this word, cherishes it. The word cherish is a beautiful word. It's the word that means to warm. So you have to warm your wife. In the Old Testament, it is an equivalent word is for a bird to sit on the eggs. You know, you want to incubate the eggs, you sit on the egg. So the Bible says sit on your, no, you don't sit on your wife, all right? But you warm your wife. You have to love her with warmth and tenderness. See, we men can treat our wives in a very cold way, isn't it? We can give her the cold shoulder. When things don't go our way, we can sulk and pout, sit in a corner, withdraw, and just ignore her, give her the cold treatment. But the Bible does tell us that the church is nourished, is cherished by Christ. And that's the way, husbands, we should treat our wives, to cherish her, to warm her. You say, Pastor, how do I warm my wife? Aircon control or what? How do I warm my wife? How can I be warm towards her? Can I suggest to you very simple things? I know guys, we are not very good at such things, right? At least Singaporean guys. Chinese guys, we very standoffish, we are very awkward, but you can do very tender, sweet things, and you may practice it tonight, all right? Suggest a few things to you. Number one, use touch. But use touch in a non-sexual way, all right? Married man, you know, you may touch your wife for sexual reasons, but no, real love is sweet, and using a touch in a very non-sexual way, just to show your affection for her. It can be a simple thing like holding her hands or giving her a hug. You know, a story is told of a couple who visited a marriage counselor, and they had problems in a marriage. They couldn't figure out why, and a counselor heard them throughout, and he finally found the problem of their marriage. So he stood up and said to the wife, would you also stand up? And when she stood up, he went over to her and gave her a big hug, big squeeze. And then he said to the husband, this is what your wife needs. Do it for her every single day. The husband looks at the counselor and says, all right, so what time do I bring her back to you tomorrow? We're not very good at showing our affections for our wife. Takes a handshake, not handshake, holding her hands, takes hugging her. It takes maybe a simple kiss every single morning, and I've already told you the benefits of kissing in a marriage relationship. You get to live 5 years longer according to statistics, and you earn generally more than the other person who doesn't kiss their wife in the morning, 20 to 30%. It's quite a lot, right? statistics. But beyond that, we do all that because we want to cherish our wives. Now, besides touch, it may also involve speech and language or your words towards her. And something that wives would always not get sick of hearing is, your laugh, don't have words. So what are the words wives you like to hear? Three magic words. Oh, how come I'm not hearing properly? The three magic words are, I love you. Some men, I tell you, I'm a hypocrite when I preach this message, all right? But some men, we just find it so difficult to say, I love you. It's almost like, I want to kill you to say those words. Or some of us have this mindset, but I've already said I love you on wedding day. And if there's any change, I would have told you. But that's not what your wife wants. Your wife wants you to every single day reaffirm sweet words to her. To us, we call it sweet nothings. Really nothing lah, because no change what. But that's not what a man and a woman, that's why men and women are different. We need to show affection with our touch, with our words. And maybe one more thing, we need to show our affection with our ears. You gotta listen to your wife. I know that's a very dangerous thing to do for husbands. Dear, would you like to tell me what happened today? Wow, then you got to be stuck for a long time. Maybe, some of you. And it's a dangerous thing sometimes to say, but it is often a necessary thing also to say. Just recently, my wife said, you should ask me, what is it, Winnie? She's outside. You should ask me, how's my day? Every day. She wants me to ask her. I mean, I think I know what's happening in your life, but that's not the point. It's not the information that I need. It's the emotional connection that she needs. So, husbands, would you begin by asking your wife, how's your day? Let me say this. If you want to do that, you've got to be very prepared, all right, for a few things. Number one, the way a wife talks and the way we communicate is very different. So if you ask her how's her day, she may talk about something and then she goes to another thing and then to another thing. It's like going around the world. You know why? Because there's this theory, I'm not sure, I didn't find this in the Bible, that this theory that men are like waffles and women are like, you know what? Women are like spaghetti. You say, why? Waffles are compartments, boxes. So man likes to think in compartments, in boxes. I'm generalizing, of course. But men are good at focusing on things. That's why you can hide in your room and do your project for a long time, come up with a great invention like Steve Jobs. Apple, he can stay there and focus for a long, long while. That's the strength of a man, but that's also the limitation of the man. He can't go from subject one to subject two very easily. So, for example, when he sits in front of the TV, he watches the TV, he's in the TV box. And when the wife is talking, he can't get out of the box. She's talking, but he's not definitely not listening. He's just in the TV box. So it's not easy for a man to switch gears. He's a waffle thinker. But a woman is not a waffle, generally. A woman is a spaghetti, or her mind works like spaghetti. And you know, spaghetti is one strand, touch another strand, touch another strand, touch all over the place. So she can start talking about baking a cake, then she can go about the school bus, then she can talk about the dress, and then the current affairs, and then how she feels, her grandmother's story last time. And it's like, where did it go? I mean, it's like this spaghetti is just going everywhere. And for the man who thinks like a waffle, he's saying, wow, this is very stressful from this box, and he's jumping all the time. But the woman is just gliding along. And also, it's difficult because women speak more than men. Do you know that? I'm told that women speak 45,000 words a day. A man needs to speak about 15,000 words a day. And most of the time, 15,000 already used up in the workplace. So when you come home, it's going to be a difficulty because she has 45,000 words to say to you and you probably have nothing else to say. But she needs to be listened to. She needs. That's why she has to tell you all the things, because she's not really telling you information. She just wants to have emotional connection. And so one of the best things you can do for your wife is to listen to her. Listen to her. So how can I be sweet? How can I be sweet? I can be sweet with my touch. I can be sweet with my words. And I can be sweet with my ears. That's how you are sweet to your wife. And would you do that? Because I believe Jesus loved us sweetly. Isn't it so? Throughout the Bible, God's love letter to us, He's always telling us how much He loves us. He's always telling us. He's not ashamed to show that, isn't it? And the Holy Spirit is in us to pour out the love of God in our hearts. He wants us to know. And as a husband, if we are to love our wives the same way, then we must be demonstrative and we must be willing to cherish our wives. True love is sweet. But let me move on to point number four. This switches gears. Point number four says true love is not only sacrificial, sensitive, or sweet. True love is sanctifying. This is taken from Ephesians 5, the way Jesus loved the church. The Bible says that he might sanctify her. That is to say, set her apart, make her pure, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. How did Christ love the church? He loved the church so much that he died for them, died for us, died for the church. Cleansed us of our sin, and is always bringing us towards the path of holiness, of righteousness, of purity. A husband is to love his wife by bringing her to the path of righteousness, of purity, of godliness. In other words, a husband has to take responsibility to lead his family spiritually. Too often we see in churches men taking a back seat and the wives taking a front driver position in saying, kids, we must go to church. Kids, we must study the Bible. Hey, we all should serve the Lord. And the husband is just staying back there, relaxing, chilling out, because all he's concerned about is his career. No, that's not being a responsible, good husband who loves his wife. Good husband is the inspiration for the family, taking spiritual leadership. He leads by example. He studies the scripture. He grows in Christ. He dedicates himself to the Lord's service. He loves the people around him. He takes steps of faith. He is a true leader. He doesn't just tell his wife to do this, do that, but he himself believes God, loves God, serves God. A true husband sanctifies. You see, the wife is the reflection of the husband in the home. If our wives have faults and failures and are spiritually lacking, the first place to look is my spiritual leadership in the home. This is a godly husband talking here. He doesn't say, my wife just doesn't love God, not spiritually interested, it's all her fault. No. A good leader takes the buck. A good leader doesn't say, it's their fault. A good leader says, first of all, it's my fault. And so he takes spiritual leadership. He watches his wife and he sees his own leadership. The success of it or the failure of it. But he is absolutely accountable. And he takes his calling from God seriously. I'm the head of my family, which means I'm to lead my family towards Christ. Do you know at the end of the day who is going to be more accountable for your family? Your kids, yourself, your husband, your wife? I find this very interesting that when Adam and Eve sinned, God said these words. The Lord God called to the man and said to him, where are you? Interesting, leh? Because who sinned first? Eve. But God is calling who into account? Adam. Why? Because he is the head. That's why I say to you, the husband, you don't have a lower standard to meet. You have a higher standard to meet. You are the leader. God looks to you. He knocks on your door and asks you, what are you doing with your family? True love is sanctifying, leads the family in spiritual things. But let me end with point number five. I hope the husbands will not really give me a punch today, all right? No one gave me lunch last week, by the way. This week, therefore no punch, all right? But the last thing about true love. True love is not only sensitive, sacrificial, sweet, and sanctifying. True love must be steadfast. Hollywood love is variable. Fleshly love is variable. I love you when I feel like it. I don't love you when I don't feel like it. I love you when you fulfill me, but I will not love you when you don't fulfill me. That's the wrong kind of love. That's the love of the world. That's the Hollywood kind or brand. But the love we're talking about in the Bible is the Christ-like love. It's the what we will call the agape love. It's the God and divine love. And the God-like divine love is an unconditional love. It's a steadfast love. It doesn't fade away. It doesn't fade away. You see, so many times we watch movies and TV serials and they say, when my wife changes, or when my wife does not meet my needs anymore, or, hey, when I married her, she's not like this. So when we have all these things, we find them as excuses to tell ourselves we don't have to love her anymore because she's changed, because she's not who I expected her to be, because she can't meet my needs anymore. No excuse when you see the love of Jesus Christ. He loved us while we were yet sinners. And you love your wife regardless, because your love is to be an unconditional one like that of the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, it's very easy, folks, to fall in love. All young people here and all of you who are married, you know it's very easy to fall in love. But it takes divine grace to stay in love. But true love is steadfast. It doesn't change. You know, there's this couple who were lying on bed, old couple, they were lying on the bed, and the wife is just remarking, you know, dear, I miss those days. The early days when we were married, when you would nibble at my ear. You know, tender, affectionate, sweet love. You would nibble at my ear. The husband immediately got up and went out of the room. She says, where are you going? And the husband says, I'm going to get my dentures. How we wish our love would last till that day, isn't it? That we'll keep loving each other. Because real love is steadfast. Like I said, I feel like the biggest hypocrite preaching this message. But this is what the Word of God has to say. My question to all of us, including myself, all you men and myself, this is the question you should ask yourself. You shouldn't ask yourself, is my wife respectful or submissive? That's what you pray for her for. That's what she has to settle with God. But for you and I, let's ask ourselves this question. Lord, am I a loving husband? Or am I lording over my family? Am I a real man who serves and sacrifices? Or am I someone who just abuses my position for my own sake? This is the question. Am I a loving husband? Some of you may have this question. I want to dispel a few questions. You may say, but Pastor, I don't feel like I can love. I don't feel it. Can I say something about feelings and love? This is, I think, very helpful for me. By Dr. Tony Campolo. He said this. I challenge those who come to me for marriage counseling this way. If you do what I tell you to do for an entire month, I can promise you that by the end of the month, you will be in love with your mate. Are you willing to give it a try? When couples accept my challenge, the results are invariably successful. My prescription for creating love is simple. Do 10 things each day that you would do if you were really in love. I know that if people do loving things, it will not be long before they experience the feelings that are often identified as being in love. Love is not those feelings. Love is what one wills to do, to make the other person happy and fulfilled. Often, we don't realize that what a person does influences what he feels. See, this is the paradigm. We think that we need to feel like we love our wives before we do things to love our wives. But biblically speaking, love is an action word. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. We were His enemies. But He did it. And so I say to you, we must not hide behind the excuse that say, I must feel like it before I can serve my wife. No, you do what love demands of you to do. And you'll be surprised. What a person does will influence how he feels. So, let's not have excuses for ourselves. I don't feel like loving my wife. See how Jesus loved you. And go ahead and do it. Love your wives. But you say, Pastor, I forgot what you say already. Well, you got 5S, so many things. I can't remember lah. So we give ourselves another excuse. So can I give you no excuse and summarize for you the loving husband? In practical things, number one, your wife needs you to be the spiritual leader of your home. She needs more than just a steady paycheck. Don't ever say to yourself, because I earn the money, I've done my part. No. She has needs beyond financial stability. She needs you to be a spiritual leader at home. Number two, she needs you to be her teammate in raising the kids and taking care of the home and provide her some time away from the home too. Raising kids is not the ministry of your wife alone. It might be some of our thinking in Chinese families, but according to the scripture, it is the responsibility of both parents. And if there is anyone who is in charge, not the wife, the husband, the father. Number three, she needs you to treat her like a princess. She does. She may not look like a princess already, it's okay, but you are still to treat her like a princess. Unconditional love. Treat her with sweetness and affection. Treat her as if she was perfect and watch the difference in her. It's amazing how love will enable someone to flourish. You don't wait for her to flourish before you love her. You love her till she is lovely. Remember that song? And that's what it's all about. Number four, she needs you to communicate with her. Dear, how's your day? That's the opening line, all right? If guys, you do not know how to talk, just, this is my wife's recipe for me. Just ask me, how's my day? Oh, you all laugh, right? Never asked before, is it? Husbands, ask. Oh, try it, all right? Try it this week. Try it every day. Do it for 30 days and soon you'll want to ask more, all right? Number five, she needs her friends and needs you to allow time with the girls, but ultimately she wants you to be her best friend. Number six, she needs you to be a AAA encourager, to appreciate, to affirm, and to admire her. Hear her say you're thankful for her. Hear her, let her hear you pray to God that you're thankful for her. Affirms her, appreciates her. Number seven, she needs to feel emotionally filled before she desires to be sexually involved. Number eight, we'll deal with that in 2 weeks' time. Number eight, she needs you to understand that there are some things you will never understand. It's true, men will never understand some things. But notice this, all right? She'll need your shoulder at times more than your mouth, more than an explanation of why she feels like she does. Because the real problem is not the problem. The real problem is her emotions that are attached to the problem. And in the sharing, she wants you to understand her and affirm her and connect with her. So this is about the loving husband. I close with a testimony of true love by Dr. Robertson McCookin. He's a man of passion. You can go back, Google on YouTube his name, and there'll be a video called A Man of Passion. He's a man passionate for God. He doesn't have a passion for selfish things. That's what is remarkable about his passion. Actually, a lot of us have passion, but our passions are always mostly self-generated and self-centered. But remarkable thing about Robertson McQuilkin is that the people say he's a man of passion for God. He has a heart for the Great Commission. He loves to see souls saved. And so for 12 years of his life, he went to plant churches in Japan. And he was successful because he really loved the people. He learned their language. He studied how biblical theology would sit best with Japanese mentality. And according to the video which I watched, it is said that Robertson McQuilkin was successful because the people saw the integrity of his life and saw the way he treated his wife. Let me say this. I believe true Christian ministry is not going around with our mouths alone. True Christian ministry, and especially missions, is when you have a real life to back it up. He did. And people saw the way he had run his family, served his family, and loved his wife. After 12 years, he returned to the States and became the president of the Columbia International University. Served there for 22 years. Wrote many books, some of which we have used in GLCC, Life in the Spirit course was one. But what is most remarkable about Robertson McQuilkin and what he's most famous for is probably the way he resigned from his presidency as in the Columbia University. His wife, his lifelong partner for 40 over years, was stricken with Alzheimer's disease and was slowly fading away. And he dedicated himself and said that, "I will quit my job and give my life, my time to serving my wife." I don't think I'll put it anything better than Robertson McQuilkin himself. And so here is a video to show you and to hear from you exactly what he said.
"I haven't in my life experienced easy decision-making on major decisions, but one of the simplest and clearest decisions I've had to make is this one, because circumstances dictated it. Muriel, now, in the last couple of months, seems to be almost happy when with me, and almost never happy when not with me. In fact, she seems to feel trapped, becomes very fearful, sometimes almost terror, and when she can't get to me, there can be anger. She's in distress. But when I'm with her, she's happy and contented. And so I must be with her at all times. And you see, it's not only that I promised in sickness and in health, till death do us part, and I'm a man of my word. But as I have said, I don't know with this group, but I've said publicly, it's the only fair thing she sacrificed for me for 40 years to make my life possible. So, if I cared for her for 40 years, I'd still be in debt. However, there's much more. It's not that I have to, it's that I get to. I love her very dearly, and you can tell it's not easy to talk about. She's a delight. It's a great honor to care for such a wonderful person."
I hope the Lord is speaking to your hearts. If our Christianity doesn't change our life, it is not worth anything. Christ did not die just to give us a ticket to heaven. He died to change us, to sanctify us, to purify us. He came to change our lives, our homes, our marriages. This morning, He wants to do the same. So come with a tender, tender heart, humble, receptive to the role of the husband. Stand up and be a true man, man who would love his wife, give for his wife. It's not easy. It takes a whole lifetime to learn and to grow. But would you commit yourself? Because Jesus committed Himself to you. How sad when we are hardened in our hearts towards our wives. How sad when the mystery of the gospel is marred in our homes because we are disobedient and will not be humble before the Lord. How sad when the person we pledge to love with all our heart for until the end of time will be left in the cold. But what glory. What glory when you love your wife as Christ loved the church. What glory when your wife sees you and she sees Jesus. What glory when your kids look at you and they see Jesus. What glory when your friends, your colleagues, your family sees you and they see Jesus. What glory it brings to Jesus Christ. This morning, it's not about you. It's about Christ and His gospel. It is to be represented in your home, the Lim family, the Tan family, the Wong family. It's to be seen in your home. And man, God has called you to be the leader. Adam, where are you? Come back to God today. Turn from your ways. Be broken before Him and experience afresh and anew the empowering grace of God to enable you to live and to love as Jesus did. All you dear wives, would you at this time be praying for your husband? Not to use this message as, again, a hammer against him, but would you pray for him? It's tough. Just as it was tough for you to hear the message last week, this is tough. It's really, really tough, and only Jesus is enough. But let's pray that we will all, both husband and wife, through the marriage pilgrimage, become the real deal, where indeed mystery becomes majesty. So whatever there is that you need to make in your heart, decisions before the Lord, prayers, would you do that right here, right now? You know, it's not about someone else beside you. It's not about anyone else. It's about you. It's about me. May God have mercy. My dear friends, if you're here today for the first time, I just want to encourage you. This is not so much about husband and wife only. I want to tell you about Jesus. I want to tell you about His love. If you see this love as amazing, near impossible, let me say this. Someone has already done it for you. Jesus has done it for you. He knew your needs. He sacrificed Himself. He tells you He loves you. And He will love you unto the end because He gave His life for you while you were a sinner. And His call is out to you today. Come unto me. Come unto me. Turn from your sin and believe in Jesus Christ. He sets you free. And you know what? When you receive this love of Jesus, that's where you truly flourish. That's where you truly blossom. That's where you truly find life. And so if you're here and you do not know Jesus, would you receive this love as Jesus woos you today by His Spirit through the preaching of His Word? It's a step of faith, of turning from sin and believing in Jesus Christ. Father, we thank You today for Your Word. So much that is spoken, so much that needs to be processed. But by Your Spirit, we pray we will hide Your words in our hearts and seek to live it out by the empowering grace of Your Holy Spirit. So bless each family here, bless each and every one. We thank You. We pray all this now in Jesus' name. Amen.